Only 8 attendees are there, 8. Till now, 11 attendees only. Still, students have not joined because the same link is there that was used in previous lecture, but I have sent that link again today. Only 18 students joined. Okay, I will not waste too much time. Am I audible? Saurabh is there? Kunal is there?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Then I think only 21 students there, I think. Not more than it. I will share screen directly then. The recording is already started, but sometime it may pause automatically. So if possible, those having laptop, please just click on the recording button. If it stops, then only. Because during lecture, I think I cannot understand whether it is continue or stop. The 23 attendees till now only. Okay. So remaining students, please join fast. You are already late. And this is my today's second lecture actually. I already conducted one lecture on third year. Yesterday, or in last lecture, we already started the parallel organization of, sorry, physical organization of parallel platforms. And after that, we have studied the ideal parallel computer, PRAM. Please mute your audio as well as videos. So parallel organization of parallel platforms, sorry, physical organization of parallel platforms already started. Then we have seen the ideal parallel computer, then their classification. Then we have discussed about the what is exactly ideal parallel computer and how it works. Then its physical complexity, how you can represent in terms of big O notation. Then we have started the interconnection network for parallel computers, that is the static and dynamic network. Static is also called as the direct networks, and dynamic is also called as the indirect networks. Then a diagram that is showing static and dynamic interconnection networks, that is also shown, that is static two nodes are connected on peer-to-peer basis, whereas in case of dynamic network, they are connected through intermediate switching elements, or you can say the hops. If you see there, there is no direct link between sender and receiving processor. Then we have discussed about the interconnection network, then the total number of ports and degree of switch depending on the number of input lines and number of output lines that switch have. That kind of let's mute your mic. Then network interfaces, we have discussed how you can interface your processor or machine with the network. That point is also discussed. Then we have started the network topologies, if you see there. So from the network topologies, we have discussed about the bus based topology. Then after that, we have seen the their examples, that is the bus having the bus based interconnection having the local cache and be with sorry with no local cache and be with local memory and caches. That is discussed in last lecture. Then we have discussed about the network topology crossbars, if you see there. So it is having a number of processing elements, row wise and column wise memory banks. So interconnection point indicates the switching element, using which you can connect with the respective memory bank and access the data from that particular, or write the data in that particular memory bank. Then cost of crossbar switch, that is also discussed. It grows as per the number of processors goes on increasing, and it is of the order of O of P square. Then we have discussed about network topology, multi-stage networks, that is also discussed. Their diagram or interconnection, if you see, that is also discussed. Stage 1 connected with 2, 2 with 3, 3 with 4, 4 with up to n minus 1 with n. And for nth stage, those memory banks are connected, and stage 1 having the processors, if you see there. Then network topology, same, that is the multi-stage Omega network, that is also discussed. And there, how actually the data is transmitted, that is also discussed in last lecture. And in case of the network topology, multi-stage Omega network, they are having the two operate modes, that is the crossover and pass through. If you see, those both we have discussed, and how these two modes work, that is also discussed in last lecture. So this is a recap about the last lecture, that is the how the data is sent from the 010 to the 111, or the 1102, if you see there, 100, that is also discussed. And how blockage takes place in common link AB, if you see there, because both that is the packets, you can say, want same communication channel AB at a time. Then moving towards the next topology, that is nothing but the completely connected network. And out of them, we have already discussed, I think, star topology. Okay, that is completely connected network of 8 nodes. Then star connected network of 9 nodes. So a diagram, we are having the all nodes are connected with remaining all nodes in that particular network. Whereas the in diagram B, every node is connected to the central node, if you see there. And drawback of the second, you can check the network is, if central node is the bottleneck, means if something happen, or if central node crashes, then entire network will come down, if you see there. That will be the drawback or limitation. That is also seen, I think, in last lecture. So in case of the star connected network, if you see, there is common node at the center, and distance between any pair of nodes is order of 1, directly 1 to 1, like the pair to pair connection, you can say. And central node can be a bottleneck. And if you see there, star connected networks are static counterparts of bus or bus topology, if you see there. Then moving towards the next topologies, that is the network topologies like linear arrays, meshes, and KD meshes, if you see there. And how connection is established in a linear array, each node has two neighbors, left and right, if you see there. And if that is current node having the left node as well as the right node connected, it is referred as 1D torus or a ring, if you see there. And this is also called as the 1D network, if you see there, or 1D torus connection. And a generalization to two dimension has nodes, that is current node having the its left, right, above and below, means east, west, north and south, means it is connected to four different nodes or processors, if you see there. This is called as the two dimension torus network or interconnection. Similarly, further generalization to D dimension has nodes with 2D neighbors, if you see there. Okay, so current node having the 2D neighbors, that is the node below it which is connected to current node having the two dimensional connection already. If you see there, that is called as the we can say 3D connection. And likewise, a special case of a d dimensional mesh is a hypercube, and here d is equal to log p, where p is the total number of nodes or the processors in that particular network. So we will see these examples in the form of diagram, network topology, linear array. First one, that is the current node is connected with the left and right side node, that is A with no wrap around and B with wrap around. Wrap around link means that is first is connected to the last node. Okay, so this is the example of the linear array topology. It is also called as the 1D torus interconnection. Then network topologies 2 and 3 dimensional meshes. If you see there diagram A, it is showing the 2D mesh with no wrap around. So every node having the that is the node to its east, west, south, north. I mean 4 nodes are connected to the current node. If you see there, A indicates the without wrap round and B indicates the with wrap round. Same diagram is the wrap round means first node from the first row connected to the last node from the first you can say the row. And similarly, second row, third row, fourth row, and in case of the columns also, that is the first processing node from the first column is connected to the last processing elements from the same column, and so on. You see there, it's called as the 2D mesh with wraparound link, or it is also called as 2D torus interconnection. And last one is the 3D mesh with no wraparound. If you see there, 3D mesh means if you see there, each element having its below element that is the 2D connection. If you see there, that is they are connected with the 4 different elements already. If you see there, so this is a 3D mesh with no wraparound. Okay, so these are the 3 examples of the meshes: 2-dimensional A, 2-dimensional without wraparound, B, 2D mesh with wrap around, and third one is the 3D mesh without wrap around. Okay, then moving towards the network topologies, hypercubes, and their construction. That is 0D hypercube is there. If you say that 1D hypercube, 1D means that is one processing node connected to one another processing node. That is one is connected with 0. 2D hypercube, that is every processor is or processing node is connected to other two processing nodes. 0-1 connected to 0-0 and 1-1. Likewise, 3D hypercube, that is the every node is connected with three other processing nodes. For example, 0-0-0 is connected to 1-0-0, 0-1-0 and 0-0-1. Likewise. And this is 3D hypercube. And 4D hypercube, if you see there, same is there. But in this case, every node is having the connection with the 4 other processing nodes there. If you see there, so 2 3D hypercubes are shown, and that is the each node having the, you can say, the connection with respective nodes, which is present at the same order or the fashion in the second 3D hypercube. Okay, they are connected with one another. For example, 0-0-0 is connected to 1-0-0-0. Okay, then 0-0-1-0 is connected to 1-0-1-0. Then 0-1-0-0 is connected to 1-1-0-0. 0-1-1-0 is connected with 1-1-1-0. Likewise, so this is the 4D hypercube connection. So question might be in your mind, why this interconnection is required. So this is required in order to communicate that is the one processing node with the other processing node. how they can send message, how they can receive message, how they can read data from memory or whatever, okay, to complete the you can say the parallel computation, if you see there. So such type of topologies are required there. So this is hypergroup and their construction. So you can construct the hypercubes from their lower dimension, that is hypercubes of lower dimension, because we have constructed 1D hypercube from 0D, 2D from 1D, 3D from 2D, and 4D from the 3D hypercube, if you see there. So properties of hypercubes, if you see, the distance between any two nodes is at most log p. P is the number of processing nodes. Then each node has log p neighbors also, if you see there. Yeah, the distance between two nodes is given by the number of bit positions at which the two nodes differ, if you see there. Distance between, yeah, two nodes is given by the number of bit positions at which the two nodes differ. If you see there, that is the, consider the 2D hypercube 01, okay, any, sorry, 00 is the node we will consider. 00 and 01, it is differed by the position 1, if you see there. Then 01 and 00 and 10, it is also, I think, one and two. Yeah, this is second node you can consider connected to the 00, if you see. Similarly, 10 and 11, it differs by the 1. So likewise, this kind of, you can see the, it is showing the distance between two nodes. It is nothing but the number of bit positions at which the two nodes differ. Then moving towards the important network topology, that is the tree-based networks, if you see there. Okay. So as far as the tree-based network is considered here, if you see, that is the circle indicate the processing node, and you can see the square here indicate the switching node. Okay. So A is the static tree network and B is the dynamic tree network, if you see there. Number of nodes are same in both diagrams, A as well as B. But what is difference between diagram A and B? In case of the diagram A, there are no, you can say the switching elements. Okay, because that is square indicates here switching node or switches, if you see there, or switching element. These are the processing nodes, if you see there. Okay, so they are responsible to establish the connection, if you see there, between two nodes, if you see there. Okay, that's why it is called as the dynamic network. B is the dynamic, whereas the A is the static network. If switching nodes are present in your tree, then it will be referred as a dynamic tree network. If no such element present, then it is the normal tree network or static tree network. Then modifications of the B, that is dynamic tree network, is the flat tree network is there. In this way, case that is the link is, we can say, flattened from terminal nodes towards the root node, if you see there. That is the bandwidth goes on increasing towards the root, if you see there. So that kind of network also we'll see. But before that, you will see the network topologies, that is the properties of the tree topology. The distance between any two nodes in case of the tree is no more than 2 times log p. P are the number of processing nodes in that network. And links higher up the tree potentially carry more traffic than those at the lower levels. Yeah. For this reason, a variant called a fat tree patterns the link as we go up the tree. Yeah. So that example also we'll see. They just discussed regarding this particular type of tree, fat tree or flattened tree. And trees can be laid out in 2D with no wire crossings, if you see. And this is an attractive property of trees. So we'll see the that example given in current slide. Network topologies, fat trees. If you see there, links goes one, number of links goes one increasing as you move from bottom to top towards the root of the tree. So bandwidth also ultimately goes one increasing, if you see there. So this is the network topology, fat trees. Okay, so it is having the in this current example. If you see there, only terminal 16 nodes are the processing nodes, if you see there, and other nodes acts as a switching nodes, if you see there. So this is also the again one example of dynamic tree network, fat trees. So this is the fat tree network of 16 processing nodes. Then yeah, so here we have finished different network topologies, right? From static network or direct network category, or dynamic network, or the you can say the indirect network category also, if you see there. Then moving towards the next topic that is connected with the same topic, that is the evaluating static interconnection networks, if you see there. So what is diameter of the network, then what is bisection width, and what is the cost, or how you can compute the cost of your network, if you see there. So diameter of your interconnection network, so this is regarding static interconnection networks only. Okay, diameter means the distance between the farthest two nodes in the network, if you see there. So the diameter will differ the network topology to topology, if you see there. For example, diameter of linear array is p minus 1, that of a mesh is 2 times root p minus 1, likewise. Okay, so you have to remember only here diameter, the distance between the farthest two nodes in the network. And bisection width, next term is there. Bisection width is nothing but the that is by cutting the minimum number of wires. Okay, how you can divide the network into two equal parts. So this is called as the bisection width, the minimum number of wires you must cut to divide the network into two equal parts. So that number, bisection width means minimum number of wires. Okay, so in case of the, I will give you example here, the bisection width of a linear array and tree is 1. You need to cut only one wire. That of mesh is root p, likewise. Then cost of network, the number of links or switches, because it is the costlier in your network, number of links or switches. So links, you can consider the wire and the switching elements like the switches, routers, bridges, likewise, if you see there. So cost means the number of links or switches, whichever is asymptotically higher, and is a meaningful measure of the cost, if you see there. So you have to remember these terms, that is the diameter, bisection width, cost. Sometimes question may be there, define the following terms considering the static interconnection networks, that is the diameter, bisection width, cost, and compare the diameter, bisection width, cost of the different networks, that is the, you can say static network, dynamic networks, static networks, again bus, then multi-stage interconnection network, and likewise, then tree, then you can say the completely connected binary tree, flattened tree, likewise. Then one graph, table is also added in that case. Okay, this table indicates the different types of networks and their diameter, bisection width, and cost. Cost are here nothing but the number of links, if you see there. Okay, cost is measured either using the number of links or the switching elements. So completely connected network having diameter 1, bisection width p square by 4. Our connectivity p minus 1, our connectivity we are not considering, but given here. Then number of links p time p minus 1 divided by 2. Star diameter 2. Diameter you should know, that is the farthest distance between two nodes. Bisection width means minimum number of wires you need to cut in order to make equal two networks, or divide your given network into two equal network. Okay, that is in case of star is 1, our connectivity 1, cost again p minus 1. Complete binary tree, diameter c, 2 time log of p plus 1 divided by 2, bisection width 1, our connectivity 1, number of links again p minus 1. Linear array, diameter p minus 1, bisection width 1, our connectivity 1, cost p minus 1. So you have to remember at least few examples and their diameter, bisection width, and cost here, because this will be fixed for connected network, star, then binary tree, linear tree. It will not change. Okay. Again, in case of the 2D mesh, no wrap around. Diameter is 2 times root p minus 1, bisection width. Then cost is 2 times p minus 1. Hello? Okay, anybody driving and watching or attending lecture? That kind of sound I am hearing here. Yeah. Around mesh network, then hello, am I audible?
Yes sir.
Okay, yes, and side yes. Okay, recording is in progress. If you see, yes, that sir. Is if recording is stopped, please start from your end, that is just click on start recording. Okay. Then hypercube is there given, wrap around KRE, D cube is also given there. So you need to remember examples, few examples, and their diameter, bisection width, and the cost or the number of links you see there. Then this is for the static interconnection network. Then similarly, you can compute the diameter, bisection width, and cost for the dynamic interconnection networks also, if you see that. So we have taken these examples. Network crossbar, diameter is 1, bisection width p, then cost will be p square. Omega network log p, bisection width p by 2, cost p by 2 again. Dynamic tree is also 2 times log p, bisection width 1, and cost again p minus 1. So this is about the evaluating static and dynamic interconnection network. Okay, so you have to remember here definition of diameter, bisection width, and the cost also, and you should able to remember the at least two topologies and their diameter, bisection width, and cost from static category as well as the dynamic category. Then next topic that is also related to whatever topologies we have studied, how we can compute the communication cost in parallel machines, you see there. So again, how to compute the communication cost in that case, you will use different terms like T-com is cost of communication in a given network, TH, that is the hop time, TW, that is the per word time. L stands for the number of links. Okay, that kind of terminology you need to remember here. So along with idling and contention, communication is a major overhead in parallel programs. If you see there, that is called as T communication or communication cost, and it is dependent on a variety of features including the programming model semantics, the network topology, data handling and routing, and associated software protocols also, whether you are using the TCP, UDP, SMTP, likewise FTP, that kind of software protocols also responsible. Then moving towards the message passing cost in parallel computers. So you need to remember again these three important terms in case of the message passing cost in parallel computers are concerned. So total time to transfer a message over a network, it comprises of following three important you can say the parameters, that is the TS, startup time, then TH, per hop time, and TW, per word transfer time. So while computing the communication cost of your network, you need to consider these three parameters. These are the three important parameters, TS, TH, TW. Along with this one, you have to consider the one more parameters, M. M indicates the number of words of the message, and L, so that is just lowercase l, indicates the number of links. These five parameters you have to consider while computing the communication cost of your network. Okay, so what is TS? This is the startup time, that is the time spent at sending and receiving nodes. So this is not a actual time of data sent or data received, or that is the that particular node is sending data or started sending or started receiving. So this is just time of this can be considered as idle time, like the it is just started executing the routing algorithm, or it started executing the or it has just initialized the router likewise, and after that it can start sending, if you see there. So that startup time is called as the TS. Then per hop time, TH. So again, each intermediate node or the hop element or a hop node, if you see there, or it may be the switching node. This time is a function of number of hops. Okay, because we have assumed here each hop taking the equal number of TH time. So it includes factors such as switch latencies, network delays, etc. So that kind of you can say the time is considered in case of the TH, latencies and network delays. This is called as the per hop time, TH. Then TW is nothing but the per word transfer time. So actually TW includes the all overheads that are determined by the length of the message, which your message is about to start transmitting from the sender. Before that, okay, means this includes bandwidth of links, error checking and correction, etc. So before starting the transmission of your message, whatever difficulties faced by the your message, if you see there, that is called as the per word transfer time, TW. So it may include the link bandwidth of links, then error checking mechanism and correcting mechanism, etc. Okay, so you have to remember these three terms here: startup time, per hop time, and per word transfer time. Then so under communication cost in parallel machines, we'll see the what is store and forward routing. If you see that, because this is important point from the as per as the message passing cost is concerned. Okay, so hop is nothing but you can say the it may be the switch or the router, because that intermediate hop may store incoming packet for some time because it is having its internal buffer, and as per the routing table it will forward to the destination node. That is, the address of that destination node is present in the packet header of that particular message. You know, you already studied. So message traversing multiple hops is completely received at an intermediate hop before being forwarded to the next hop. Then the total communication cost of a message of size m words to traverse l communication links is, so you have to remember here m indicates the number of ports in that message that is you want to send or transmit, and l indicates the lowercase l number of links through which your message will go. If you see there, so tcom is nothing but the communication cost for your network, that is the in case of the store and forward routing. Tcom equal to ts is the startup time, okay, plus mtw. M indicates the number of words in message. TW is nothing but the per word. TW you have seen, no? Just seen. If you see there, it is nothing but the per word transfer time, TW. Remember this one. So this is nothing but the difficulties faced by the message. Okay, if you see there, while it is ready to transmit. M into TW plus TH. TH is nothing but the per hop time, that is the it is the switching element delay. If you see there, or network delay, th well multiplied by the l, it indicates the number of links. So this is the you can say the communication cost for the store and forward routing network. Tcom equal to ts plus mtw plus th multiplied by l. Okay, but in most platforms, if you see there, TH is small. TH is nothing but the per hop time. If you see there, this is means in some network, TH is small means it may be negligible or it is not present. You can assume that one. In that case, TH equal to zero. So your expression will become in that case T communication cost equal to TH plus MLTW as TH is zero. Okay. So it will become your communication cost. So sometime question might be there, that is the how we can compute the communication cost for the store and forward routing network. So you have to use these three terms there. If you see there, TS, TH, TW, then what is meaning of these terms, and you can represent this using these two equations or expressions, you can say. So this is about the store and forward routing communication cost. Then what is time now? Still we have time, I think. Okay, routing techniques. Okay, so current slide indicates the three different diagrams. If you see there, that is the elements having P0 to P3, P0 to first diagram, second and third diagram. Okay, so in case of the first diagram, that is the uppermost diagram, here we have used the store and forward network. This is the single message sent over a store and forward network, a store and forward routing network. If you see there, so there is no message in transit. If you see there, but in second example, that is you are sending a message from P0 to P3 through intermediate nodes P1 and P2. Okay, in every example. Example A, B and C, if you see there. In second example B, the same message broken into two parts and sent over the network, if you see there. And here gray part indicates the message in transit. if you see there. Transit means this message may not received on that particular node, or it is not completely sent towards the next node yet from the current node. You can see there. Then in case of the diagram C, the same message broken into four parts and sent over the network. So you can say the this is called as the cut through routing, right? Now that is the message is we have divided into more number of parts. In case of the second example, two parts. In third example, it is divided into four number of parts likewise. So if you see current example, that is you are passing a message from node P0 to P3, and that message is passing through intermediate nodes P1 and P2. If you see there, so diagram A, through a store and forward communication network. This is the example of store and forward communication network. And diagram B and C, this is nothing but the extending the concept to cut through routing. If you see there, and the shaded regions represent the time that the message is in transit, just discussed. And the startup time associated with this message transfer is assumed to be zero. That is the TS, that is startup time. Okay, that is assumed in this example as a zero. If you see that, so these are the three examples showing the three different routing techniques. That is the store and forward, then cut through routing. If you see that, and the third one, second example, cut through routing by dividing the your message into two equal parts, and third example, message is divided into four equal parts likewise. And you have assumed here startup time TS as a zero in this example. So packet routing you have studied already. That is the here you are using store and forward makes poor use of communication resources. Yeah, because at every intermediate node you need to store that packet temporarily before it is forwarded on a next outgoing link. Then packet routing breaks message into packets and pipelines them through the network. And if you see there, since packets may take different paths, each packet must carry routing information. That is the its header, packet header should contain the source node address and the destination node address also. Then it should contain error checking mechanism, then sequencing error, because those packets should be forwarded in a particular sequence, and that those should be received in a particular sequence at the receiving end also, and other related header information. The total communication time for packet routing is approximately is given by T communication cost equal to TS. TS means startup time plus THL. TH is the per hop time multiplied by the number of links L plus TW, that is per word transfer time TW, into M indicates the number of words in that particular message that is being transmitted. If you see that, the factor TW accounts for overhead in packet headers. If you see there, that is the overhead regarding the word transfer, that is due to the packet headers. So this will be the communication cost for packet routing given. Then regarding cut through routing, what happens here? It takes the concept of packet routing to an extreme by further dividing messages into basic units called fleets. This example, I think we have already seen, that is we have divided packets in messages into two equal parts, then four equal parts likewise. Since fleets are typically small, the header information must be minimized. This is done by forcing all fleets to take the same path in sequence over the you can say the communication channel. All tracer message first programs, all intermediate routers all fleets then take the same route. So in that case, you need to use the tracer message that will pass just before your actual message. That will program the intermediate routers, and they will accept that message in that particular route, or you can say link, okay, in a proper manner, or in a same link, all packets will will be transmitted. Then error checks are performed on the entire message as opposed to plates. No sequence numbers are needed. Error checks are required whether all packets are arrived or not, if you see there, in that case. So this is regarding cut through routing, how it works. Again, as far as the cut through routing is concerned, how you can compute the total communication time for a cut through routing, that is approximated by T communication, that is total communication time or cost, equal to TS plus THL plus TWN. TS startup time, TH per hop time, L indicates the number of links in network, plus TW per word time into M. M indicates the number of words in your message. So this is the identical to packet routing. However, TW is typically much smaller. Okay. So if you assume TW is equal to zero, in that case, T communication will become TS plus THL, if you see. But here we have not assumed it equal to zero. So T communication will equal to TS plus THL plus TWM for cut through routing. Then we'll move on simplified cost model for communicating messages. The cost of communicating a message between two nodes having L hops away using cut through routing is given by T communication cost equal to TS plus THL or LTH plus TWM. And in this expression, TH is typically smaller, smaller than the TS, means per hop time is smaller than the startup time, as well as the TW, that is the per word transfer time. And for this reason, the second term in the RHS does not show, particularly when M is large, means TH equal to zero in this case, if you see. So in that case, T communication will become TS plus TWM, that is shown at bottom of this slide, if you see that. And it is often not possible to control routing and placement of tasks in case of the such type of networks. Okay, so this is the simplified cost model for communicating messages. TCOM equal to TS plus TWM, and for large number of messages, TH is assumed equal to zero. That's why total communication cost TCOM equal to TS plus TWM, where TH equal to or approximately equal to zero. So and it is also important here, some point, it is important to note that the original expression is whatever modified expression we have seen in previous slide, that is TCOM equal to TS plus TWM, this one, last one, okay. So that the original expression for communication time is valid for only uncongested networks. If a link takes multiple messages, the corresponding TW term must be scaled up by the number of messages, that is the M. And different communication patterns congest different network to varying extents in that case. So it is important to understand and account for this in the communication time accordingly also. So you have to change the values of TH, then you can show the L according to the, you can show the type of network and situation. So routing mechanism for interconnection network like hypercube network is shown here. Routing a message from node P, yes, given name as 010, to node PD, that is having the name 111, in a three-dimensional hypercube using E-cube routing. So you are routing this message like this one. Step one, you are forwarding message from 010 to 110 actually. But that arrow is given incorrectly in this diagram. And step two, it is transmitting from 110 to 111. That is the PD. PS to 110 and 110 to PD. This is the, you can say, path how the message is sent from PS to PD in current hypercube using E-cube routing example. So today we'll stop here. Then regarding mapping techniques for graphs. Okay, actually mapping techniques are given in incoming unit. Often we need to embed a known communication pattern into given interconnection topology. We may have an algorithm designed for one network which we are porting to another topology, or you need to do the mapping for the different topologies. If you see there, for these reasons it is useful to understand different mapping between the graphs also. So that kind of information you should know in advance. So today we have seen some network topologies which were remaining. Then we have seen the, you can say, the communication cost, how you can compute or how you can evaluating the different static networks and dynamic networks on the basis of their bisection width, diameter, and cost. Then how you can derive the expression for the communication cost for the different networks, like the cut through routing network, then forward store and forward routing network, and so on. This kind of topics we have already studied today. So today we'll stop here, and if you have any question from your end, you can ask. I will continue in next lecture remaining.
Okay, sir.
Part. Okay. So for next 10 minutes, I am here. If you have any doubt, you can ask. Recording is in progress, Saurabh.